Macmillan Audio presents Invisible Sun, Empire Games, Book 3, by Charles Stross. Read for you by Kate Redding. Timelines. Timeline 1. History diverged from our own around 200 to 250 BCE in Timeline 1. Judaism, Christianity, and Islam are all absent, and the collapse of the Roman Empire into Dark Ages was complete, rather than just partial. Since then, civilization in Europe reemerged, and quasi-medieval colony kingdoms sprang up on the eastern seaboard of North America. The western seaboard was settled by Chinese traders. The Grunmarkt, one such kingdom, was home to the clan, rich merchant traders with the ability to cross between timelines. As world walkers, they made a good living as the only people who could send a message coast to coast in a day in Timeline 1. They could also guarantee a heroin shipment would arrive without fear of interception in Timeline 2. But all good things come to an end, and the vicious civil war that broke out in 2003, by Timeline 2 reckoning, led to the clan's discovery by the U.S. government. Their escalating cycle of retaliation ended in a nuclear inferno. Timeline 2. This is a world almost identical to your timeline, as the listener of this audiobook, right up to a key date in 2003. Here, world walkers from the clan's conservative faction detonated a stolen nuclear weapon in the White House. They assassinated the president and forced the government to reveal the existence of parallel universes and the technology for reaching them. Our story starts in Timeline 2. Timeline 3. This timeline was discovered by Miriam Beckstein. In this alternate world, England was invaded by France in 1760, and the British crown in exile was established in the New England colonies. There was no American War of Independence, and no French or Russian revolutions. Therefore, the Ancien Régime, despotism by absolute monarchy, shaped the world order until the revolution of 2003. Here, the new British Empire's Radical Party overthrew the government and declared a democratic commonwealth. This country is now known as the New American Commonwealth. The French invasion of England stifled the Industrial Revolution in its crib, so industrialization began a century later than in Timeline 2. But economics and science have their own imperatives, and even before Miriam led the survivors of the clan into exile in the Commonwealth, the pace of technological innovation was beginning to pick up. Timeline 4. Currently uninhabited, this timeline is in the grip of an ice age, with an ice sheet covering much of Europe, Canada, and the northern states of the U.S. But it hasn't been uninhabited forever. The enigmatic forerunner ruins pose both a threat and a promise. Main character profiles. Eric Smith. Born in 1964 in Timeline 2, Colonel Smith, USAF, retired, has been a government man all his life. He worked for the United States National Security Agency, then inside a top-secret unit within Homeland Security. It was tasked with defending the states against threats from other timelines. These included world walkers, those who could cross between these alternative worlds, and his own timeline. Many might consider this easy. After all, most timelines are uninhabited, or populated by Stone Age tribes at best. However, the exceptions are the problem. The notorious clan and their world walkers came from Timeline 1, and contact with this secretive organization resulted in a national trauma, dwarfing both 9/11 and the War on Terror. Smith knows that there are other inhabited timelines out there, and they're hostile. At least one vanished civilization left relics far ahead of the United States technology levels, evidence that they'd been fighting and losing a paratime war against parties unknown. And then there's the Black Rain timeline, where reconnaissance drones and human spies go missing, and air samples contain traces of radioactive fallout. Defending the nation is easier said than done, when you can't even be sure what you're defending it from. But you can make a good guess. Kirk Douglas. Born in 1941 in Timeline 2, Kirk Douglas grew up in the German Democratic Republic, East Germany, during the Cold War. Drafted at 18, he ended up in the Border Guards. Then in late 1968, he escaped over the Berlin Wall to the west and emigrated to the United States. Marrying Greta, another East German defector, he made a new life for himself. Kurt raised a family and lived quietly with his son, daughter-in-law, and their adopted children, Rita and River. The East German Foreign Intelligence Service didn't send Kurt to the West to spy on the United States. For a defector to infiltrate their host nation's intelligence agencies was considered impossible. But they had longer-term objectives in mind: to have children who would be U.S. citizens by birth, raised and trained as loyal agents of the workers' state. They'd have the perfect backgrounds to infiltrate the NSA, the CIA, and the government. But the Cold War ended, and East Germany reunified with the West before the plan could be carried out. Old skills don't fade easily, and Kurt has given Rita the best training he could for living in a police state. And she knows, if she ever gets in over her head, that she can count on Grandpa Kurt and his friends for help. Miriam Burgesson. Born in 1968 in Timeline 2, Miriam grew up in Boston, Massachusetts. She worked as a tech sector journalist before discovering in her early 30s that her mother had been lying to her for most of her life. Mother and daughter were fugitives from the Grunmarkt, a small kingdom in Timeline 1, which had reached medieval levels of technology. They were women of noble birth, whose designated role was to produce more world walkers and to serve the clan. Miriam world walked home by accident and was expected to conform. But that had never been Miriam's style. So, in short order, she discovered a route to a new inhabited timeline and built a business startup, using it to import high-tech innovations into this new territory. This triggered a crisis within the clan, reviving a dormant blood feud and causing civil war. Now, 17 years have passed since the clan and the Grunmarkt were both destroyed. Clan reactionaries made a disastrous miscalculation that led to a very brief war with the United States, ending when the U.S. nuked the Grunmarkt. Miriam saw the writing on the wall and led anti-clan survivors into exile in the new world she'd discovered. But here she found a revolution in progress and a new vocation. Miriam is now older and wiser, and a minister in government. She works for the New American Commonwealth, the ascendant democratic superpower of Timeline 3. She'd taken part in the revolution that overthrew the absolute monarchy of the new British Empire, now defunct. And ever since, she's been warning the new government, the USA is coming. For 17 years, she's been working feverishly to ensure that when the U.S. drones arrive overhead, the Commonwealth will be ready to meet them on equal terms. But she wasn't expecting them to be expecting her, and to have made plans accordingly. Rita Douglas. Born in 1995 in Timeline 2, and adopted at birth by Franz and Emily Douglas, Rita was 8 when clan renegades from Timeline 1 nuked the White House. Growing up in President Rumsfeld's America, she has learned to keep her head down and her nose clean. But there's only so much you can do to avoid attention in a national security state when the government has you under constant surveillance in case the woman who gave you up for adoption, or her relatives, takes a renewed interest in you. Rita has a history and drama studies degree, a pile of student loans, and no great employment prospects. At 25 years of age, she doesn't really know where she's going. But that's okay, because the government has big plans for Rita. Elizabeth Hanover. Born in 2002, just before the revolution that overturned the new British Empire and sent the crown into exile in St. Petersburg, Elizabeth Hanover is the only child of His Royal Majesty John Frederick IV, Emperor in exile of the new British Empire. Unmarried, she's a pawn in her father's dynastic plans, which will come to fruition on the death of Adam Burrows, first man of the Commonwealth. But her father's plans revolve around a royal marriage into the Bourbon dynasty to a prince twice her own age, who possesses a mistress, and, according to rumor, the pox. She's supposed to be the queen of a restored British Empire of the Americas. But Elizabeth isn't stupid. She's been watching the Commonwealth's technological progress from afar and laying plans of her own. Plans which will bring two nuclear-armed superpowers to the brink of war. Principal cast list. United States of America. Rita Douglas, struggling thespian. Franz Douglas, Rita's father. Emily Douglas, Rita's mother. River Douglas, Rita's brother. Kurt Douglas, Franz's father, retiree. Greta Douglas, Kurt's wife, deceased. Sonia Gomez, DHS agent. Angie Hagen, electrical contractor, childhood friend. Jack Mercer, DHS agent. Paulette Milan, a spy. Patrick O'Neill, Rita's supervisor. Dr. Eileen Scranton, deputy assistant to the Secretary of State for Homeland Security, Smith's boss. Colonel Eric Smith, DHS, head of the unit. Dr. Julie Straker, colleague of Rita's. New American Commonwealth and French Empire. Margaret Bishop, party commissioner. Miriam Burgesson, previously Miriam Beckstein, Minister for Economic Development and Intertimeline Industrial Espionage, Commonwealth Government. Erasmus Burgesson, Miriam's husband, Minister for Propaganda, Commonwealth Government. Sir Adam Burrows, first man, head of state. The Dauphin, heir to the throne of the French Empire. Princess Elizabeth Hanover, heir to John Frederick. John Frederick Hanover, the Pretender, king in exile of the new British Empire. Major Julius Hjorth, Yule, Brilliana's brother-in-law, world walker spy. Elena Hjorth, Julius's wife. Hugh Hjorth, explorer general. Brilliana Hjorth, Hugh's wife, DPR, espionage agency, director. Adrian Holmes, party secretary. Alice Morgan, Commonwealth Transport Police officer. Olga Thorold, Miriam's director of counter-espionage. Part 1. Singularity. Depend upon it, sir, when a man knows he is to be hanged in a fortnight, it concentrates his mind wonderfully. Samuel Johnson, September 19th, 1777. Drowning in Berlin. Berlin, Timeline 2, August 2020. Elizabeth Hanover scuttled along the grimy sidewalk, her shoulders hunched and eyes downcast, running away from the sour fear stink of a rendezvous gone wrong. She was two blocks away from the ground floor apartment where the major lay, bleeding and unconscious in the care of questionable strangers, when a thud that reverberated through her ribcage set her heart pounding. Was that a bomb? She wondered. It sounded like a bomb. She'd heard too many of them for comfort in her short adult life. She increased her pace as distant sirens began to rise and fall. The streetscape of this otherworld Berlin was disorienting and unfamiliar. Her Berlin was the fusty regional capital of the French imperial province of East Prussia. This Berlin was apparently the capital of United Federation of all the Germanies, in a looking-glass world where France was a republic and the Russias were splintered separate nations. And there was no respite, in any direction she looked, from the reminders of her exile. The people around her went hatless, and it seemed both men and women wore trousers. But that was the least of the strangeness. There are no horses, she realized dizzily. No ever-present road apples with their sweet sick smell of equine droppings. No boys with brooms waiting to sweep the crossings. Did they eat all the horses? Is there a famine? But there were no obvious signs of starvation around her. Indeed, there were signs of outrageous wealth. Street corner grocery stores boasted outrageous expanses of plate glass. Some of the pedestrians talked to themselves, muttering or mumbling as if they were mad, while others walked heedlessly, eyes downcast at small glowing tablets, like the one she'd taken from Major Hjorth. She'd imagined a future of melted-looking automobiles and streetcars, of flying machines and towers, but the small differences were far more disturbing. An infant pranced by in shoes with soles that flashed blue at every step, its hand held by a mother dressed in a hussar's jacket and tight trousers. A brightly lit advertising sign on a passing tram flared an incomprehensible message at her, then dissolved before her eyes into a picture of toothily smiling people. The unfamiliarity everywhere she turned her gaze was exhausting. Liz gripped the torn messenger bag under her arm and moderated her pace to avoid attention. Her heart hammered as a green-striped vehicle roared past, blue beacons flashing from its roofline and siren wailing like a damned soul. Through its windows she glimpsed hard-faced men, or women, in uniform. It was heading towards the block she'd left behind. Major Hjorth's scheme had clearly failed, attracting the worst kind of attention this world had to offer, and now she was stranded without any idea where to turn for help. Her unease veered towards suffocating panic. The major's proposal had looked so excitingly promising when she awakened this morning, but now it seemed like a snare into which she had thrust her head, and from which she could not withdraw. Major Hjorth's plan had gone off the rails when he'd been shot by Elizabeth's guards. His body armor hadn't quite stopped the bullet he took during her extraction. He'd brought her to his apartment and collapsed, so she'd taken the glowing slab of glass he called a phone, but it stopped working for her, demanding that she look at it or enter some sort of code. A stranger called Fox turned up, then called a medic, and then the doorbell rang again. Scared, Liz had grabbed the major's bag with his holdout pistol and bolted through the back door.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.